Hallelujah. Thank you that you're a God of love. Hallelujah. He loves us this morning. Nothing shall separate us from the love of God. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful to know? Nothing. Hallelujah. Let us worship Him with all our hearts. Let us do that one more time. And they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet have been standing within your gates, O Jerusalem.
For in thy courts fell 1,000 houses there. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of Israel.
For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good.
They are planting the house of the Lord. It flourished in the courts of our God.
O Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. I will sing of the glory of the King of Justice.
you, O Lord, I will sing. And before we sing, all hail the power of Jesus' name, I'm going to remind you one more time that nothing shall separate us from the love of God. Amen. Nothing. Amen. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present or things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. What a reassurance this morning of his love for us. Hallelujah. Do you feel love this morning? Hallelujah. We don't care about what's happening in the earth realm. Who don't love you? Who's talking about you? Who's this? But God loves you. Hallelujah. And for that, we will lift him high this morning. All hail the power of Jesus' name.
The power of Jesus.
to be praised this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We owe him so much. Hallelujah. Bless your name this morning, God. Hallelujah. We magnify you, Lord. Hallelujah. Have your way, God. Have your way, God. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless your name, Lord. Bless your name, God. Hallelujah. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. He's worthy to be praised. Worthy to be praised. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, bless your name, God. Oh, no, 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 no. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Good morning, church. Good morning. Praise God. Let us pray. Thank you. I must tell Jesus.
Yes, yes, yes.
I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear these burdens alone.
Yes.
Father God, we come this morning to cast all our cares on you, for you care for us. Father, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for your mercy and for your grace that you give us every morning. Father God, I come this morning to lift up our pastor, Father God. I pray that all will be well as she brings the word of God to us. Father God, I thank you for those joining us on Zoom. That all is well them as well. Father God, I pray for each and every participant of this service this morning that they will have a fresh anointing that could only come from you, God. Father, I thank you for all things that you have made possible for us as a church, Father God. And I want to say, I thank you for, as we go to conference, that you will go before us, Father God. Father God, I pray for each participant in the conference. I pray this morning for our delegate, Sister Jareen Oboy, Father God. And I pray also for our alternate, Sister Gilda Furby. Father God, be with each and every one as we go to conference this year, 2021. It's been a rough year, but Father God, we know that you do all things well. Father God, I want to just lift up our government this morning, Father God, that you would do a new thing in our government, Father God. Help them to seek you first when they make decisions regarding this country, Lord. Be with them in a special way. Father God, be with our essential workers, Father God, as they smile. Keep smiling, Father God, because we know you have everything in divine order and you do all things well. Father God, I thank you. I can't thank you enough for all that you do and all that you will do. Father God, as we come this morning, we cast all our cares on you because you care for us. Leave everything at the altar for you, Lord, because we cannot bear these burdens alone. This is my prayer and this is our prayer because we ask it in no other name but the precious name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Thank you. feel his presence this morning? Hallelujah. He's here. Yes, he is. Thank you, Lord. Sister Marion will come with the scripture.
Morning, church.
Morning.
I'm reading from Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 11 to 18. And when you found it, if you care, you can stand. This Nehemiah inspects Jerusalem's wall. I went to Jerusalem, and after staying there 3 days, I sat out during the night with a few men. I had not told anyone what my God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me except the one I was riding on. By night, I went out the valley gate towards the jackal well and the dung gate, examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down, and its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. Then I moved on towards the fountain gate and the king's pool, but there was not enough room for my mount to get through. So I went up the valley by night, examining the wall. Finally, I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I had said nothing to the Jews or the priests or nobles or the officials or any others who would be doing the work. Then I said to them, "You see the trouble we are in? Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace." I also told them about the gracious hand of my God upon me and what the king had said to me. They replied, "Let us start rebuilding." So they began this good work. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word.
Amen.
Forever, ever, ever.
Just before our pastor comes, I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate her on her 7th pastoral anniversary at Bethel. Let us congratulate our pastor for a stellar job. Hallelujah. We thank God for you and pray that the next however many will be blessed and we encourage you on this journey.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much. For indeed, God has been faithful. As we prepare to go and make this my 7th report as the pastor of Bethel, I would have you to know that I have indeed continued to grow as we continue to worship and praise God together. Our annual conference will begin on Thursday at 8:31 with our conference missionary opening service. There will be a break at 12, and the evangelists will have their service at 1:30. There will be a break, and the roll call for all pastors and members of the annual conference will and delegates will be at 2:46, dinner break at 5, and our opening service will be at 7 p.m. on Thursday evening, and the preacher will be Reverend Charles Alexander Smith. For those of you who desire, the sanctuary will be open and available. We will be showing the service here on Zoom, so you're welcome to join us throughout the day as we join in together to celebrate this, our annual conference. Amen. There is a conference booklet. I will have it sent by email and also on WhatsApp, so you can follow the events of the next few days. The pastor's reports will be given on Friday at 11 a.m. and at the 7 p.m. service, it will be the lay worship experience. Saturday will be the YPD and Christian Ed at 6 p.m. And on Sunday, we will be having our closing service at 3:30, also via on Zoom. But here at Bethel, we would have our 10 a.m. worship service. So next week, Sunday, we will be worshiping at 10 a.m. conference, and we just follow through as normal. So mark your calendars for next week at 10 a.m. It is with great sadness that I announce the passing of Sister Jean Clark. Sister Faith Clark. I had Faith done here, and I had it circled at Faith Clark. Sister Faith Clark. Sorry, Sister Jean, my apologies, a slip of the tongue, but the passing of Sister Faith Clark. The funeral will be after annual conference, but we're asking if you will continue to hold the family in prayer. We'd like to say happy birthday to Sister Grace Swan, who celebrates her birthday today. Sister Myrna Ingram's birthday was yesterday. Amen. And amen. And Sister Victoria celebrated her birthday on the 2nd of March. To all of you, we say happy birthday, and may God continue to bless you and keep you. Amen. Now let us prepare to bring our tithes and our offerings unto the storehouse of faith, that indeed, as we give, God will give unto us. He will continue to pour out his blessing into our treasuries. But I'm so glad that all of God's blessings are not just financial, that he blesses us in so many ways. So as we come this morning, let us give with thanksgiving, let us give with faith, and let us give with praise.
Amen.
gracious and our eternal God. For this offering and these gifts, Father, we say thank you. Pour out your blessing on every hand and every heart. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
We are blessing his name. Sister Gladys, I've just noticed you. God bless you. Good to see you. Hallelujah. Praise the living God. Now it's that time when we will be blessed by the ministry of Brother Malcolm Butterfield. As he, one of our songbirds, comes and renders a song unto the Lord. After that, the next voice that you will hear will be that of our beloved pastor as she breaks the word of God this morning. Hear ye her.
Hallelujah, Bethel. Praise the Lord. Are we still in the spirit of worship? We don't come to entertain as songbirds. We come to worship. I'm going to sing a piece that is well known to Bethel. It comes from Psalm 42, verse verse 1 and 2. And it speaks about David's zeal to serve the Lord. It's always great to serve the Lord. Wouldn't you agree, church? Wouldn't you say praise the Lord? So I invite you to listen to these lyrics, and I hope that it touches you so that you can always, from one day to the next, have a zeal to serve God.
Desire, and I long to Look to the Lord in prayer. Our gracious and our eternal God, indeed, God, we long to worship you. We long, God, to be in your presence, to feel your anointing, to hear your sweet voice. So, God, continue to abide with us. God, let us continue to linger with you, God, for in your presence, God, there is a sweet, sweet spirit. God, speak to our hearts and our minds this morning, that God, indeed, we will be drawn closer unto your throne, that God, indeed, we would hear your voice and align our lives, our walking, our talking in accordance to your word. Come, Holy Spirit. Speak, Holy Spirit. Use me, God. Hide me, God. Wash me, God. For your service, God. That, God, your people will hear your voice. They will feel your anointing, God. That, God, indeed, we all will be drawn closer to your throne. Have your way, God. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. I'd like to add birthday greetings to Brother Cairo, going 10 years old today. Happy birthday, Cairo. And Shade will be celebrating her birthday this week. So to our two young people, happy birthday and God bless. Our scripture this morning was read from Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 11 through 18. I would like to concentrate on verse 13, then go to chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Nehemiah 2, verse 17, and chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Then I said to them, "You see the trouble we are in? How Jerusalem lies in ruins with its gates burnt? Come, let us build the wall of Jerusalem, that we may no longer suffer disgrace." Chapter 3 and verse 1. Then Elijah said, "The high priest rose with his brethren, the priests, and they built the sheep gate. And they consecrated it and set its doors. They consecrated it as far as the tower of the 100 and as far as the tower of the Hananel. And next to him, the men of Jericho built. And next to them, Zachar, the son of Irim, built. Come, let us build. And next to him, the men of Jericho built. And next to them, Zachar." I like to preach from the title, "Come, let us build." Come, let us build. Most of humanity's greatest achievements have been accomplished not by individuals, but by groups of people working together towards a common end. In our text this morning, Nehemiah called upon the power of community as he undertook the task of rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem. The city was in ruins and disrepair. For more than 90 years after the decree of Cyrus, giving the Jews permission to return to their homelands, and it was about 70 years after the completion of the second temple that the holy city was still in ruins. Ezra had restored the temple, but little else functioned effectively
the city remained in ruins. The weakness and the poverty of the Jews and the strong oppression of their enemies prevented them from rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem. Now, nearly 90 years later, Nehemiah was empowered to perform this long neglected work. Within the book of Nehemiah, it recounts the work of repairing the ruined gates and the walls of Jerusalem. Nehemiah was sent by God to do the work. But as we view as the list of people who joined in the work on restoring the walls of Jerusalem, there are two things that we learn. No person can do the work alone. And two, the work must continue despite any setbacks. It was a great work that had to be done. And a team of people were required to restore the holy city to its former glory. Nehemiah did not and could not do the work alone. He needed help. He needed people who had a mind to work because there was much work to be done. All through this chapter, we find some very important words, small words, but yet very important. It reads, next to him worked so-and-so. And next to them worked so-and-so. Next to is an important phrase in this account. It illustrates the people were working together. Without the cooperation, it is impossible for people to come together to accomplish meaningful tasks. What one person does affects what everyone else does, making each person accountable to the team for their performance. We must note as we read through this account, the writer not only mentions the workers, but he also mentions those who did not work, what I like to call the slackers. Let's look at verse 5. And next to them, the men of Tekoa repaired. Their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervision. The men of Tekoa worked, but the nobles of the same area refused to do any work. The text does not say why the nobles did not work. All we know, they had their reason for refusing to be a part of the work. It seems they refused to give any assistance. They refused to add any labor to what was needed. They refused to give of their finances or their servants. Even though they were expected to be a part of the work, they refused to join in the rebuilding. Look at verse 16. It is there when Nehemiah says, then he told them, and he lists the priests and the nobles, all who were expected to do the work. But for whatever reason, the nobles refused to join in the work. One commentary stated that they did not work either because of their pride, their position, their laziness and neglect, or because of jealousy or some secret agreement they had with the enemy of the Jews. They refused to work. Their refusal to work showed their disregard to the authority of God himself, because the work was God's work. So their refusal to work was not against Nehemiah, but it disregarded God's authority. Restoring the walls of Jerusalem was God's work, led by Nehemiah. It was not Nehemiah's work. He was led by God to do God's work in restoring the walls of Jerusalem. You see, the nobles got it wrong. They thought it was because of Nehemiah. Whatever their reasons was, it was the wrong reason, because the work did not belong to Nehemiah. It was not Nehemiah's task, but it was God's work that Nehemiah led the people into. Whatever their reasons were, they refused to join the work. I'm not working. You're not getting my money. I'm not even going to send my servants to help. But in spite of what the nobles had decided, I'm so glad that their attitude did not stop the work. Amen. The task of rebuilding and restoring the wall continued. That even when the nobles decide to take a hiatus, to sit on the side, there is yet a remaining people who were willing to do the work. The people came together to complete the work of rebuilding what was destroyed. They had a mind to work to restore their Jerusalem to its former glory. They were united in the work of rebuilding. Let's get a better understanding on the state of Jerusalem and understanding the task that was before them. In verse 5, it lets us know that Jerusalem was in ruins. The state of Jerusalem was a mess. Its gates were burnt out. The walls were destroyed. And this was the condition of Jerusalem for over 90 years. And I'm so sure that those born within those 90 years thought that it was normal. But it was not the normal. For 90 years, they saw a disheveled city. They got used to a city whose gates and walls were destroyed. But those who knew the former glory of Jerusalem knew that this was not the norm. And now was a time to rebuild. So you see, God had called Nehemiah for such a time as this. It was Nehemiah's time to restore the broken walls, to restore the burnt out gates. So even though Jerusalem had been in ruins for so long, it was now time to rebuild. The solution is just that. Where it says, Nehemiah then said to them, "Let us build." The key word there is us. The people working together, not just the high priest, not just the nobles, not just the leaders of the community, but as we go through the account, we will see that the people came together to rebuild the city. In order to rebuild, we must come together. The solution for rebuilding what was burnt, the solution for restoring what was destroyed is that the people must come together. The state was ruins. The solution was the people rebuilding. But why was it necessary for the people to rebuild? Why was it necessary to rebuild the walls and the gates? We find at the conclusion of verse 5, it says that we may no longer suffer disgrace. You see, when the city had its broken walls, when the gates were destroyed, what the brokenness revealed was a defeated and ashamed people. The Jews who had returned to their homeland were now living in unsafe conditions. And they were living humiliated because they were living in a destroyed city. When the place and the people of God are living and existing in ruins and in broken places, it does not please God. They suffer disgrace. We need to understand that we have no place in brokenness. We have no place in ruins. But I'm so glad that through the account of Nehemiah and the walls of Jerusalem, I'm so glad that God would always raise up a servant who would restore the broken places, who would make things straight, who would get things back in order. God will always raise up a servant to restore. The brokenness is not normal. The ruins are not normal. There's no need for us to live in shame with our head hung down because of the state of our city. But because we serve a living God, that when he sends a servant to do what thus says the Lord, we will find that by the rebuilding of the walls, the disgrace will be removed. And it will show that God's blessings are on his people yet again. So it was necessary to rebuild the walls. It was necessary to restore the damage that had been done so that the people of God will no longer live in disgrace. Amen. It was at Nehemiah's call, come, let us build. It was at his call that the people came together, that even though they were living in disgrace, they stepped out of their disgrace to rebuild the city. That yes, they were living in shame because of the condition of their beloved Jerusalem. They stepped out of their shame to rebuild the city. They stepped out of their humiliation, of shame of what had become of their city. But now they were willing to step out of their humiliation for the love of Jerusalem, to rebuild the wall. They answered the call of Nehemiah, that no matter how long they had been in disgrace, they now came to work. Despite of how long they had gotten accustomed to the humiliation, they were now stepping out to rebuild the city. Everybody had a place. Everybody had a task. Let's take a moment and take a look at who was part of the rebuilding process. And as it now comes to me, there were more working than those who refused to work. Yeah, yeah. The text says that the nobles refused to work. Yeah. But guess what? There's more workers than non-workers. Yeah. That even though they made up their minds they're not going to work, God sent some workers. God had some workers within the city. God had some workers who were in shameful situations, but they were willing to work. I'm so glad that there's always more workers than non-workers. There's more praisers than complainers. That there are always somebody willing to do the work. Amen. Let me call the role of those who work. There was the high priest and then just priest. There were the men of Jericho, the men of Tekoa, the men of Gibeon and Mizpah. There were sons, and yes, there were even daughters rebuilding the wall. I'm so glad they didn't leave it just to genders. I don't know how many daughters there were, but the word says there were some women building the walls. There were blacksmiths, there were goldsmiths, perfume makers, district workers, merchants, temple servants, the residents of Zenoa, the priests from surrounding regions. They even had some priests come in and say, we're willing to work with you. There were city people. There were town people. There were families, and there were Levites. Everyone who had a mind to work came to rebuild the ruined walls. Anyone who was willing to lend a helping hand came to rebuild the walls. One may be asking, what do perfume makers, priests, goldsmiths, and anybody else know about building walls? The goldsmiths, they're experts at melding and shaping gold. What do they know about building a wall? The perfume makers, their skill, their expertise is in smelling the flowers and pulling out the best fragrances for the perfume. What do they know about rebuilding the gates? I'm so glad today that maybe they knew nothing, or maybe they knew very little about rebuilding the city. But I'm so glad this morning that whatever skills they had, they were willing to use them for the glory of God. They were willing to work. They stepped outside of their comfort zone. That means they had to leave the laboratory with all their fragrance. fragrances, but their hands were always nice and clean. But now they had to change locations and go to the walls, put their hands in the dirt, and rebuild the walls. I'm so glad this morning that there are workers willing to leave their trade for the building of God's kingdom, for the edifying of the body of Christ, that these people, no matter what their skill was willing to do the work.
Hallelujah.
Willing
Thank you, Lord.
To put their hands to the task. Man, the Levites were all about the worship. But I'm so glad there's some times when worship is not appropriate. And there's a time when either worshipers must come and join the work. It's time for us to join together in the work. Nehemiah sent out the call, come, let us build. I'm so glad. Is there in verse 16 that he calls off the list of those whom he expected to join in the work? He says, the Jews, he had not yet told the Jews, the priests, the nobles, and the officials, and the rest who were to do the work. You see, he had his list of who he expected, but I'm so glad. What we expect isn't always what we get. He thought the nobles would be there. We thought they would be there front and center, but I'm so glad that even though the nobles chose not to show up, that God had a people who had a mind to work. Here's a notice for the nobles today. You're not showing up will not stop the work. You're refusing to pay will not stop the work. Your refusal to send help will not stop the work. God has some priests. God has some daughters. God has some goldsmiths who are willing to do the work. Come, let us build. As long as you're willing to work, I don't care what your skill set is. I know that God has a plan for rebuilding his house.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Come.
Hallelujah.
Come. Let us work. Nehemiah had so marvelously organized this rebuilding effort that each group had their section, that each group had a piece of the wall, each group had a certain gate they had to rebuild. Now, if we take a look at the entire wall, they probably figured, that's too big. We can't handle that. But I'm so glad that Nehemiah had the mind to organize the work. And when we look at the text, we see that each person worked on only a portion of the wall, only a portion of the gate. When you look at verse 10, we see that one man prepared the gate opposite his house. This is my house, so I'm taking care of this part of the wall.
Hallelujah.
And then my neighbor has the same attitude, taking care of his part of the wall. Then that's a big part of the wall already taken care of. And it says in verse 23 that certain men who made repairs did so in front of their house. So I ask you the question this morning, what does the wall look like in front of your house? What does the gate look like in front of your house? You see, don't worry about the rest of the wall. Take care of your portion. God is calling us to work, but we want to grumble about the condition of the wall. Don't worry about the whole wall. Just look at your portion. Fix in front of your house. Fix in front of your gate. But when we all get together, beginning to work in front of our houses, then the entire wall will be built, will be restored, will be uplifted. But we must come and build the wall. Each person did their part.
That's right.
Let's bring it close to AME.
Amen.
Each organization
did their part.
Hallelujah.
Each church member did their part.
That's right.
We're good at grumbling and complaining about the state of the church, the state of the wall, the state of our country, but nobody wants to work in front of their house. Terry, I'm gonna complain about what your wall looks like. You ain't got your wall together. You ain't doing right. Brother Dennis, your wall's in shambles. Brother Malcolm, your gates all falling to pieces. But I haven't looked at the condition of my wall. But each person took care of the wall in front of their house.
My God.
Each person did their part. If I remember correctly, I think that wall was about some 1,000+ miles long. But if each person did their part, my part may be only 10 feet. Karen's part is only 10 feet. Brother Dennis got a big house, his part is 20 feet. Each of us, no matter what the portion of your wall is, you've got to take care of your portion. You want to restore, take care of your part. And we will see that it will all come together.
Hallelujah.
It is here in the story of rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem that an important truth emerges, that this is God's design for restoring communities that are in ruins, communities that are broken, communities where there's hurt, that they have been destroyed, that is up to the people to bring it all back together. The people must work together. God has placed us all strategically where he wants us to work. In your neighborhood, in your office, in your home, in your church, wherever God has placed you, that is your area of ministry. There's work to be done. There's walls to rebuild. There's gates to be repaired. But we're all called to come, let's build the wall. We're all called to do the work. We're all called to ministry. We're all called to rebuild that which has been destroyed. And when you are working, if you look to your right, you'll see, and the next person next to you, they also will working. If you look to the other side, they also will be working. So you need to know, but if there's someone who refuses to work, keep on working anyway. If someone objects to your working, keep on working anyway. We must know that with every test that we do, every trial that we face, that there will always be some trouble.
Hallelujah.
Here's Nehemiah and the people working to rebuild the walls.
Hallelujah.
Then comes along trouble. The names are Zambalet and Tobiah. Here they are doing God's work. And they become angry about the restoration of what's been broken for 90 years. I want you to know that there are some people who's not going to be happy about you repairing the broken wall. You see, there are some folks who are content living amongst the rubble, living amongst the broken pieces. They're satisfied with the dysfunction. And who are you to have the audacity to try and fix it, to try and get things right? We've gotten accustomed to this. Things have always been like this. You can't change this. You can't fix this. Zambalet and Tobiah got royally angry because they were repairing the city of God. Not everyone's going to be happy when you're fixing. Not everyone's going to be happy when you're trying to repair. But God has a standard that he's calling his people to. Don't let the complainers, don't let the objectors, don't let the slackers stop you from doing what God has called you to do. There's a work
to be done. There is work to do. Let them complain. Let them object. Let them slack off. But we must keep on working.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Now, Reverend, what? Hold up for a minute. We're working, and the normals refuse to help. They refuse to give, and they refuse to send help. That's going to mean more work for us, Reverend. That's okay, because as we look within the text, we will find that where there is a slack, God will lay it on somebody else's heart to willingly go and do another piece. If you don't believe me, you need to see that Hanun and the residents of Zenoa, they repaired the valley gate, and they also repaired about 1,500 feet up to the dome gate. I don't know if that would have been the nobles' portion, but they were willing to go over and beyond what their call of duty was. They could have said, we've already repaired the valley gate. We've done our task, but I'm so glad that it wasn't about what I've accomplished. It wasn't about what I've done. They were willing to go further and do more than what was required. Not only the people of Hanan, but also the men of Tekoa did some extra work. And after them, the men of Tekoa, and that's in verse 30-27, repaired another section opposite the great projecting tower as far as the wall of Ophel. So you see, because the noble men stopped, God would always lay on his heart individuals who will go the extra mile. And I'm so glad for those individuals who go the extra mile, because in going the extra mile, the wall was completed. Some are stuck. I finished my part. The front of my house is done and in order. Karen, hurry up and finish yours. But when you've had a heart of God, you'll step over and help Karen finish her part.
Hallelujah.
And when she's finished, the two of you go over and help Brother Dennis
yes.
to finish his wall.
Amen.
But you see, don't let the nobles. Now, who were the nobles? They were some of the leaders. As Reggie calls them, some of the mock demarks. When he said that, I said, who, what? Some of you older folks understood what mock demarks was. He had to break it down for me. But there's upper crust people who thought they were too good. That we've been here all these years and I'm not doing nothing. We were here when they rebuilt the temple the first and the second time. And you're calling us to do the... When you do nothing, don't you know God will always raise up someone to pick up the slack? Because it's God's work. It's not about you. It wasn't about Nehemiah. It was God's work that had to be done. They were determined that not even the slackers or the objectors would stop the work from going forth. Nehemiah sent out the invitation. Come, let us build. And in order for the people to answer that invitation, it meant the people had to unify. They had to come together, working together, putting personal issues aside, putting personal agendas aside. They were working together, working for God, working to restore, working for a breakthrough, working to vitalize the city, working to remove the disgrace. Is there anybody in the house today who's willing to work to remove the disgrace? Is there anybody in the house today who's willing to work to restore? Anybody in the house willing to work for God, willing to put aside your personal agendas, willing to put aside your issues and work for the kingdom of God?
Hallelujah.
Are you willing? Are you willing this morning to take up the invitation and say, come, let us build? But first you must come. Come together. Come in unity.
Come and step outside of your house and build. Come and step outside of your comfort zone and build. Come and join the work. You may not know how to build a wall, but you know how to take instruction. You may not know how to put cement and mortar together, but you know how to follow the instructions of God, that when we come together, then the walls will be rebuilt. Then Jerusalem will be restored. Then the temple will be restored. And all of God's people can gather in the holy city to worship and magnify the Lord. When we come together, when we work together, God is able to do more than we can ask, think, or imagine. But we've got to come together. Walk together, children. Don't get weary. Walk together, children. Don't get weary. Don't worry about who's not working. Don't worry about who's complaining. Don't worry about the objectors. Just do what thus said the Lord, for there is work to be done. So come on, Bethel. Come, let us build.
There's no room for slackers on this construction job. There's no room for objectors on this construction site. When you join this crew, there's one leader, and that's God. Nehemiah had to obey God. The people had to obey God through Nehemiah. But I'm sure there were those who had those issues with Nehemiah. But it wasn't about Nehemiah. We're all called to obey the instructions of God. God wants to rebuild our city. God wants to restore our city. God wants to restore our gates. They've been living in shame, in disgrace, because of what was going on in the city. But it's when we come together and work together that God will restore. Hallelujah. Nehemiah didn't restore. God restore. You want your city to be restored? Come, let us build. You want your family restored? Come. Let us build. Amen. You want your island restored? Come, let us build. One house at a time, one individual at a time, one pew at a time, one trade at a time. But we've got to come together and watch God restore. Our gracious and our sovereign God, indeed, we thank you that, God, you can restore that which has been broken, that which has been burnt out, that which has collapsed, that which has been sitting in ruins for generations. God, we come to you this morning, God, praying that you will instill upon each and every heart that, God, we will forget what we've become used to. That, God, we will see that you've got a greater plan for our Jerusalem. That, God, you've got a plan that you will bless all people who enter into her gates. But, God, we've been living in shame. We've been living in ruins. We've been living amongst complainers and doubters. So God, this morning we come to you, Father, saying, God, forgive us, God, for taking our eyes off of you. We come this morning, God, saying, Lord, we're heeding the call. We want to work, God. We come as tradesmen. We come as doctors and nurses. We come as financial people. We come as corporate Bermuda, God. We come as pastors. We come as secretaries. We come as handymen, God. But God, we're coming.
that God we come with any gifts that you give us. God, you and instructors where and how to build. So God, forgive us this morning that indeed, God, we will hear your voice, that God, we will follow your leadership, that God, we will be obedient to your word. God, have your way. We're turning Jerusalem back over to you, God. For 90 years, we've been trying to get it right, trying to fix it, God. But God, is only when we walk together, pray together, work together, God, that God, you will restore. So God, on this Sunday, before we go to make our annual report, God, regardless who is at the head of this part of Jerusalem, that God, we declare we will work for you, God, that we will do what you've called us to do. So God, have your way. Continue to work on hearts and minds, God. Call the nobles of the house to realize, God, they're only dishonoring you, Father. They're disregarding your will and your way, God. So work on their hearts, God, not to stir up trouble, but God, to join the work. And God, we give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In the name of your Son, our Savior, let every believing heart say amen, amen, and amen. Is there one this morning who that you've seen the brokenness, you've seen the ruins, and you've wondered, I can't do nothing about it? And it sat and sat and sat and sat, and it bothered you, but you felt you couldn't do anything about it. I want you to know, everybody, each and every one of us, have a part in restoring the walls of our Jerusalem, the walls of our community, the walls of our church. The goldsmith had a part to play. The daughters had a part to play. Everybody from the high priests, the Levites, everybody had a role. You have a place. You have a place. You have a place. But we must all come together and work for God. The altar is open. Maybe you're on Zoom and you desire to join the work, put your hand up. Either your virtual hand or your literal hand, Sister Carmen will see you. We'll join you in the prayer. Maybe you're in the call line and you're desiring to join the work. Let us know that you too are joined in this prayer. I may not see your hand, but God sees. God knows your heart. And that what he's going to answer today, and what I may not see over Zoom or on the call line, your change in behavior, your change in attitude will reflect one day, that we will see that you've joined the work. There's much work to be done. Come. Come, let us build our Jerusalem. We praise God this morning for his word, for his anointing, for his power. Nehemiah sent the call out, and in that in the 18th verse, they replied with, "Let us go and build." And they strengthened their hands. So let us this morning reply and say, "I'll go." Now let our stewardesses prepare for our celebration of Holy Communion.
Thank you.
that truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbor, and you intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in God's holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling. Let us repeat the general confession. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and weakness, which we from time to time most grievously hath committed, by thought, word, and deed, against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your wrath of indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever, hereafter, serve and please you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of your tender mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto you, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us through everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we shall at all times and in all places give thanks unto you, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your holy name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory be to you, O Lord Most High. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifolds and your great mercies. We are not worthy as much to gather the crumbs from under your table, but you are the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful souls and bodies may be made clean by his death and washed through his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of your tender mercy did give your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his oblation of himself, once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father. We must most humbly beseech you and grant that we receive in these your creatures of bread and wine, according to your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who in the same night he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which was shed for you and for many for the remissions of sins. Do this as often as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me.
must keep it in memory, the Calvary experience. Let us keep it in remembrance. Wash away my sins, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And as we drink together today, let us remember as they put a crown of thorns on his head, blood flowed down his head. As they nailed him to the cross, the blood trickled yet again. As they pierced him in his side, both water and blood flowed for our salvation. When they nailed his feet to the cross, he bled, he died, that we may have eternal life.
Amen.
Let us drink in remembrance of him.
Thank you.
Let us repeat the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, we, your humble servants, desire your fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching you to grant that by the merits and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and your whole church may obtain remissions of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto you, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and our bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto you, humbly beseeching you that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be filled with your grace and heavenly benediction. We beseech you to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto you, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. Glory be to God in the highest, and on earth peace towards all men. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give thanks to you for your great glory. O Lord, Heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You who takes away the sins of the world, receive our prayers. You who are sitting at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen. And the peace of God that passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and in the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and forevermore. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. And they sang a hymn and ran out. I know it was the blood.
Nearly 1,000 channels curated just for you. AccuRadio.